Hi everyone, and welcome to Biology Professor. Today we're talking about photosynthesis and cell respiration. Basically, we're going to look at how those two are connected and what they have in common. Now, they're actually a lot more connected than most people think. They're part of a larger cycle that starts with energy that comes from the sun. That sun provides light energy that is absorbed by chloroplasts. This is where photosynthesis happens. Photosynthesis yields two types of products. First, organic molecules. The most common you'll hear about is glucose, so a type of sugar. The other major product yielded by photosynthesis is oxygen, or O2. Organic molecules like glucose and oxygen are then used by mitochondria in cellular respiration. This is where the mitochondria has enzymes present that, through several complicated steps, break down organic molecules, use oxygen as a final electron acceptor to generate something very, very important, ATP. ATP is basically the energy currency of the cell. It's like a dollar bill. Everywhere in the cell takes it. And this is where energy is stored that the cell can later use for a variety of cellular processes. Now, where does the cycle part come in? In mitochondria, with cell respiration, once they have used the organic molecules and the oxygen, there are two different products that are formed. These are carbon dioxide and water. Carbon dioxide and water are the two reactants that chloroplasts need to carry out photosynthesis. So that is how this is one big cycle. Now let's look at what these processes, photosynthesis and cell respiration, what do they have in common? Well, they both use electron transport chains. Electron transport chains are these series of enzymes that are part of biological membranes that pass electrons from place to place within that chain, and in so doing, they harvest energy from those electrons and create something called a proton gradient. The proton gradient is then used in both photosynthesis and cell respiration by ATP synthase. And this is another common misconception. People think that ATP is only involved in cell respiration. And it's true that cell respiration is where the cell gets the ATP that it needs for all of its different functions. But photosynthesis has ATP synthase as well. In photosynthesis, ATP synthase is used to generate ATP in an early step of photosynthesis that is then used up in a later step of photosynthesis, where the organic molecules are being made. So ATP is a part of both of these things. Also, both photosynthesis and cell respiration occur in plants, algae, and photosynthetic bacteria. People are tempted to say that autotrophs, like plants, use photosynthesis, and heterotrophs, like animals, use cell respiration. That's true. But actually, plants use both, and algae and photosynthetic bacteria, they use both. They use the photosynthesis to generate the organic molecules and the oxygen, and they use the mitochondria that they have for cell respiration to get the ATP that they need for all of their various functions. Now, I also want to mention as a side note that photosynthetic bacteria, you might be saying, well, how can they have photosynthesis? They don't have chloroplasts. That's true. Bacteria are prokaryotic cells and they lack organelles. So they don't have chloroplasts, they don't have mitochondria. Instead, the enzymes that are used in photosynthesis and cell respiration, they have as a part of their plasma membrane, instead of being specifically in the cell in these compartmentalized places. Now, another thing that the two processes have in common is that they use biological membranes for increased surface area. What does this mean? Well, cells are very small places, and they have a lot going on inside of them. You see that chloroplasts have this double membrane system, and then on the inside, they've got more membranes. The membranes here are in black. And the mitochondria also is a double membrane. You've got the outer membrane, and then you've got this inner membrane that has lots and lots of folds. These folds are called cristae. In chloroplasts, all of these individual little ovals are called phyllocoids. And the phyllocoids, when stacked together in a column like this, form what's called a granum. But regardless of the terminology, in both cases, you have a lot of biological membrane that is folded up into a very little space. And it's these biological membranes, the thylakoid membranes and the cristae membranes, that hold those electron transport chains, where a big portion of photosynthesis and cell respiration is happening. So by having all of these folds, or all of these stacks of thylakoids, this provides a lot of increased surface area so that photosynthesis and cell respiration can happen at a very high rate. There's a lot of it going on at once because it has all of this surface area to work with, even though it's in these small compartments. And finally, another place that photosynthesis and cell respiration are linked is in the endosymbiotic theory. This theory deals with the evolution of eukaryotes. So eukaryotes, as different from prokaryotes, eukaryotes are the cells that have a lot of membrane-bound organelles. So organelles like chloroplasts, like mitochondria, but also other organelles as well. Lysosomes, endoplasmic reticulum, the Golgi apparatus, the nucleus, all of these are specific to eukaryotes. The endosymbiotic theory says that mitochondria and chloroplasts are special, though, that they were formed when an early ancestor of eukaryotic cells engulfed a photosynthetic prokaryote that then became a chloroplast, and a non-photosynthetic prokaryote that then became a mitochondria, and that these two organelles come from this ancient symbiosis that was formed when prokaryotes were engulfed by an early eukaryote. So that is one other thing that photosynthesis and cell respiration have in common. That is it for today. I hope you enjoyed, and thanks for watching.